what's neat this week. It's January. Happy New Year. In this episode, I start talking about Soundtraxx decoders and a feature inside of them called Dynamic Digital Exhaust, which is a really cool feature. I show how it works on the video with Hill Tests. Later on in the show, Jeff Myers stops by with some gorgeous Tangent Illinois Central Golf Hoppers that he has just finished with his weathering effects, and he discusses with us and shows us how he achieved those effects. A little bit later in the show, I talk about my photographic props, my roller carts that I use that I put all the props on, whether it's other people's props or dioramas and things that I've finished. These things fit in the car, they're versatile, I discuss that a little bit, and at the very end of the show, I talk about weather, and that is what 1-inch hail does to garden railroad track, and also what happens when you get 6 inches of rain and your house is not a boat. I literally, my layout got really wet that day. So enjoy the footage and the clips, a lot of high 8mm stuff this time, for this January 2015, What's Neat This Week. For this segment of What's Neat This Week, I want to talk about Soundtraxx digital decoders and something inside them called Dynamic Digital Exhaust. Now, you may or may not know that Soundtraxx and Blackstone Models are one of my new accounts for the past, I want to say past year. And I went kicking and screaming at the electronic stuff because A, I didn't understand it, but B, once I read the manuals, I completely understood it. I could not believe how simplistic it was. And there's a couple of features that I'm going to talk about over the next few months on my What's Neat This Week segments. And the one I'm going to talk about today, and the reason that I've got all these crazy hills that I've created in dual gauge and narrow gauge, is to demonstrate dynamic digital exhaust. And what that is when you adjust CV 177 through 188 and you kick in a little bit of delay, a little bit of CV 3 and 4, adjust those so that when you adjust the throttle you've got a slower response. I call that delay. And what that allows you is that triggers what's already in all Tsunami digital decoders. Intermountain Steam, Athearn steam locomotives, the narrow gauge Blackstone steam locomotives. This feature's already in the decoders. You don't know it because you've got to activate it. Again, by adjusting CVs 177 through 188, 3 and 4 with a little delay, and what you end up with is, as the engines are going up the hill, they're lugging, they're chugging, they're making heavy exhaust sounds. And then as they crest and come over the other side of the hill, you hear a little rod clank, the chuff subsides, and it's all automatic because inside the decoder and inside the locomotive, it senses the load. And as you're going downhill or you're coming to a stop, you get the brake squeal, you get the rod clank. It's an incredibly effective feature, and I want to demonstrate it in this What's Neat This Week with this upcoming video clip that really kind of shows you all the features. This feature can also be demonstrated on a short level track on your layout. As I give the locomotive some power with the throttle, you'll hear the locomotive's labor with a deep chuff. Then as I back off the throttle, they'll get quieter and you'll hear the rod clank. Experiment with this. I think you'll find that this is going to make your locomotives brand new all over again. Thank you.
Hey Ken, what are you doing?
Well, I'm gonna tell you. If you ever get into model railroad photography, you're gonna find that you need photo props that you can set your dioramas on top of. Now, for the last 15 years now, I've been using these wooden props that fit real well into my automobile. I can put anybody's diorama on top of them and then shoot their models live on location or shoot them here in my backyard. Today I'm refinishing them. You've got to do that about every 2 years. Put a nice fresh coat of polyurethane on it just to keep the wood from rotting. This is one that I just finished yesterday. And as you can see, she's shiny, waterproof, and it's gonna be good for another 2 years of use. So I suggest to you guys that you build something like this, because in the last 10 or 15 years, I've perfected the fact of taking these out, putting my models on them, and shooting them. It works really well for me, and it's gonna work really good for you too. What are you shooting today, Jeff?
Three Illinois Central Gulf tangent hoppers that I finished a while back.
Oh, these are tangent. These are very nice, aren't they?
Yes, probably some of the best freight cars out there.
I can see your oil paint weathering effects here.
Yep.
Weathering's pretty nice on this car. How did you get this darkened effect like this?
Most of it started out with some oil paint washes and filters, and then for some of the wavy panel grime effect, dry brushed on just a little bit of oil paint on your brush and kind of feather it out, blend it in to give it kind of where it's got the wavy panel where the grime collects in the waves of the sheet panel on the hopper.
It looks really good, man. Thanks for sharing it with us.
Thank you.
For this segment of What's Neat This Week, I want to discuss a new video that I have available at kenpatterson.com. It's building trestles and bridges. And in this video, I discuss and show you the process of how I built Leitner Trestle on the Rio Grande Southern, milepost 159, bridge 160A. And this is the famous bridge where Bob Richardson shot number 464 running across it on one of its final runs plowing snow. So I will show you from start to finish how I built the bridge, went about building the diorama, building the road, scene reconstruction, talking about creeks, pouring creeks out of Envirotex, talking about girder structure building, and overall complete scenery. And then we go further and discuss how to wrap the diorama in black oak to make a flexible, movable section of your layout that's completely safe, because you know if something like this flexes, the bridge is going to break into pieces. So watch this, look for it at kenpatterson.com, a video on building trestles in large scale and HO scale. We cover an awful lot in an hour and 5 minutes on this new exciting video. So go check it out. For this portion of What's Neat, I want to bring you in from the very bottom floor of designing a photograph from the very start. That's the design, the concept, and then the final product. And I want to walk you through the construction. For this assignment, this is an Athern project. Chris Palomares at Athern found this really cool photograph on the internet by Steve Patterson. And what it is it's a blur shot where somebody in a vehicle driving pacing alongside a DD40 shot this incredible photograph. Steve Patterson shot this photograph. And it exemplifies power, it exemplifies, it shows speed, it shows movement. So how could we design a photograph like this for Athern in the HO scale dimensions that we need in order to create the shot? We could use Photoshop and maybe go with the blur effect to get the blur of the grass effects. But that still means that we've got to design a scene that matches the prototype location exactly. That's easy because all the answers are in the photograph right before our eyes. My theory on designing something like this would simply to be design a double track main line, put the locomotives on the back track, have the front track and the whole front foreground scene be movable. Maybe we can design it, spray some pledge on the foam, slide it while I shoot the photo, and create the same movement effect. So let me think about this for a few hours and see if I can come up with a design concept and show you how it progresses. And this is the design of what I've come up with. What I've created here is a scene where the front portion, like I said, will slide. So while I'm shooting the photograph, I can take long exposures. It's a cloudy day shot that'll help me with the sliding movement to show it on film. So I'll slide this at various speeds and go through the photographs. But let me bring you up to what I did to get to this point to create this scene. First, I experimented with foam and sliding sections just to see if the feasibility was doable. And then what I did was I glued everything down with the commercial grade hot foaming glue, the foam glue. They come out with a really nice nozzle for putting it down. And I glued all the sections down and then I weighted them. I put a lot of heavy weights on. This foam doesn't expand very much and the glue sets up in about 2 hours. So after all the weights set on it, I then started gluing down the track, experimenting with the sliding just to make sure everything worked out the way it was supposed to work out. Then I started carving the foam. I used a Stanley Shure planer, the small handheld planer, and I used a large rasp to go through the contours and match the topography that was in the photograph and started and carved through the foam. Then what I wanted to do was create the grass effect using good old-fashioned fake fur. So I put the fake fur down, and then what I did was I came along with hair clippers and I shaved and I broke up the fake fur so that it looked like individual weed tufts so that it would look really good for the blur shot. Then what I did was I sprayed it with some green paint. I used Hunter green paint and just sprayed it out of the can, which works really well. Set it to dry for about 3 hours. And then what I did, I needed to build a road. I needed the road with the line in it. So I took patching cement, and what I did was, using a 4-inch trowel, I built forms on each side and poured the road about 1/8 inch thick, and then pulled it smooth with water and the putty knife, which makes for a great cement road using this latex cement patch mix. Then what I did was, of course, I had to go and spray the whole scene with Woodland Scenic cement so that everything would stay in place and then be ready to do the shot. And so this is the real results that I've come up with. So let's see what happens next during the photo shoot. Here we are at shoot day. This is when all the efforts come down to just one moment. This is where it all counts. So we've got our scene set up that I designed out of foam. It's all set up now so that while I'm shooting the photograph, this is gonna slide and allow me to create the effect of blur, which is what we're after. Plus the benefit is the prototype shot was shot during a cloudy day. I've got great clouds today. I never imagined the time that I would call clouds great. I always want sunshine for my shots. But in this case, in order to create the mood and atmosphere for the photograph, and one other thing is, because it's cloudy and it's a little bit darker, I can shoot longer exposures. So I'm going to be shooting exposures of exactly 1 second, and then I'm going to try 1.25 second long exposures while I'm moving this. So that means I'll just move it about 1/16 of an inch to 1/8 of an inch while the shutter's open, which should give me just the right amount of blur to look good in the photograph. So let's see how this turns out. Okay, what I'm doing is I'm sliding this, like I said, and I'm shooting 1/2 to 1.3 second exposures on this. And let's just see how this turns out right now. Let's do this for real. I didn't move it that time. Here we go, we're sliding it. I'm shooting shots while it's moving. Everything's set up. This should work out really well. Not very complicated. The telephone pole right there should look good. The railroad ties should look blurred. The grass should look blurred. And I got plenty of shots here. Let me try it one more time and I think we're done. And that's it. Figure I'm gonna give this to Chris Palomares at Athern. He'll add a little bit of smoke, maybe a little bit of lighting effects, and we should have one really interesting photograph to share with everybody. So let me show you now, this is how the photograph came out. See the shot? It matches the prototype shot. It's got the blur effect in it. I'm very satisfied with the results on this. Chris Palomares, in fact, did add the smoke. He did add the running lights to the truck and just kind of tweak the color a little bit in the photograph to add a little bit more yellow to the gray skies that I've got right now. So thank you very much for watching this What's Neat This Week photographic tip for this month of January. There's nothing like a great storm for the grass in the summertime to help cool things down. But one time, there was an area where it rained, just over an area of a, I want to say, for my, where I live, maybe a mile and a half in all directions, and it rained and it rained, and the storms kept training and building right above where I lived. And what ended up happening was, even though I live on the very top of a hill, somehow with about 6 inches of rain that we got within that hour and a half period of time, railroad tracks washed out down below, the cliff washed out in 33 places between here and Peabody, Missouri, just down to DeSoto Sub, and my layout inside was absolutely inundated with water. Let me show you a video clip of the scenario and sort of how it went down. I know that looks crazy, and that was a lot of water coming in here, but I'm happy to say it didn't do any damage to the layout, partially I believe because everything's sealed with polyurethane and underneath everything's held up with metal studs. So no damage from that little episode of water, and it's never happened again. One thing that I do remember was another weather event, and that's hail. Hail one time, golf ball size, the great big stuff, took out 50% of the railroad ties on the Garden Railroad in the backyard. Let me show you that real quick clip.
This one I went up twice real hard.
And what hail does to Garden Railroad track is as it impacts it, it just breaks the spikes right off. So I lost about 200 feet of track outside that afternoon of 400 that's out there. So I lost half of it. And what I mean is the ties were broken off the rail, and what I had to do is get new ties, 6-inch sections, and just simply re-slide them on to the 6-foot pieces of track that are flex track that's out there. So not too bad. I apologize for the lack of quality of the weather footage, because this is all high 8 material that I was able to capture. The hailstorm took place in 2003, and in 2009 is when this place flooded out the way it did. So appreciate high definition with this next clip that I'm working on, a sunrise shot to end this January's What's Neat This Week. I hope winter is being good to you wherever it is you are.